about the way I've lived a life adrifter, waiting for the day when I take your hand and sing your songs, and maybe you would say, come lay with me and love me, and I would surely stay.
There has been a rock movement in India for long, unbelievingly as long as from the 1960s. These pictures are from the 60s, a time that probably gave birth to India's first rock band. In 1968, a band called the Great Bear was formed in the Park Street of Kolkata.
When Sergeant Pepper's the Beatles' most creative and musically interesting album came out, I was already hanging around on Park Street, and Trinkers was a restaurant where the young kids would go on Sundays for 4 hours. There would be a jam session and all the hits would be played by very, very good bands. The other very important thing was the standard of musicianship of the local musicians was very high.
Indian rockers did not have a great time dealing with society. For the society, they were a useless bunch of rebellious drug addicts, like anywhere else in the world.
I know my friend was a sales executive with Metal Box and Company, and they looked down on the fact that he was in a rock and roll band.
A big movement in the West was leading musicians to become peace activists. This was a time when the scene in India had just begun. Woodstock 1969 was not a huge impact on Indian bands.
We were aware of the protest against violence, and we shared the same thoughts. But the way it was politicized in the West, it was not to that extent over here. We still considered Bob Dylan as a guru of music and not of social change.
Interestingly, by the 1970s, rock concerts and competitions made way in India. A magazine called Junior Statesman began organizing rock and roll concerts and gigs around the country.
This magazine organized a beat contest. The finals were held in Chennai, and we won it. And somewhere there is a picture of Mr. Amitabh Bachchan giving us the prize. I don't know where it is, but it's there.
By then, there were many Indian rock and roll bands. To name a few, High from Kolkata, The Great Society from Shillong, People from Mumbai, and a band called Shiva that came along to be known as one of the most touring bands in India. That period was what we know as the acid era. Long hair and carefree attitude. Drugs began to define the sound of music.
The influences did come, you know, into us, like Brown Sugar, Acid, Charas, you know, Grass as we call it also. And at that time, you know, you're young, you're really not educated, or your parents don't know, you know, that this is right and that is wrong. And for us, it was like a an experience. Okay, these guys are doing it, so we should do it too.
The acid era began affecting the sound of Indian rock as well. Distortion and psychedelic music came in like a piercing needle. Distortion was in the air.
Distortion, yes, you're absolutely correct. There were people, companies started manufacturing the wah and, you know, the distortion. And then they sort of got into better sounds, you know, like maybe distortion, but maybe a distortion with a compressor, maybe just a sound which is slightly, is not a clean song.
Because of drugs, many musicians ended their careers with a high. The only difference, it was a high of a different type. On the other hand, Bob Dylan's influence was growing in India by the day. It was in that period when Lou Major, the frontman of the Great Society, decided to celebrate Bob Dylan's birthday every year. And till date, the man taps his foot on Dylan's music. Interestingly, he also credits Bob Dylan for his life.
Love, respect. For the man has given so much to the world.
There came about many a bands by the early 80s. The acid era seemed to have ended. Five young guys in Mumbai with spunk in their attitude saw a difference and formed Rock Machine. Rest became history. Watching rockers on my home screen every day. Rags to riches, the rock and roll way. The pain seemed like so much fun now that he's on top. All you gotta do is knuckle down and give it all you've got. He's on top. Luckily for us, in a way, that era was over, you know. So we were, I think, more a drinking band rather than a druggy band in any way. Rock Machine was originally Rock and Roll Machine. The incident that led the band to be named as Rock Machine and not Rock and Roll Machine speaks volumes about the monetary circumstances of Indian rock bands at that time. The talent was there, but money wasn't.
There was an organizer who wanted to do a show for the band, and he said, and I think there was no name, so they said, you've got to have a name, I need to put something on the poster. So there was an album that everyone was fond of, I think it was called Rock and Roll Machine or something, and they said, all right, the band is called Rock and Roll Machine. So he says, okay, and then 2-3 days later, he comes back with a small little poster and he says, look guys, I don't have too much money and Rock and Roll Machine isn't going to fit on the poster, so I've just put Rock Machine. So everyone said, hey, but you know, we had decided on Rock and Roll Machine. He said, I'm sorry, if you want to do the show, it's Rock Machine. So that's how the name came by and it stuck for a long time. Yeah.
By the late 80s, new sounds were explored in India. Heavy metal began making its way in the country. And their inspirations were bands like Iron Maiden and Black Sabbath, and not the Beatles. They believed in original music. Playing covers was no longer a cool thing. It's the original attitude that mattered.
I think a pop musician, I think he's going to get scared by experimenting with something on stage, because he's always used to the acclaim and the admiration, the affection of his listeners and his audience. A jazz musician, a hard rock musician, never really gets scared because they're used to people saying like, what are you doing? You're playing nonsense, I'm not interested in it. So we were used to it, you know, we were prepared for it. And in fact, we were surprised when it started working. We did it because we believed in it. We were angry young people, we had a lot to say, we had a lot to shout about, a lot to be angry about.
In 1988, Millennium, headed by the then long-haired Vernon Ibrahim, released the first album on an audio cassette, first by any Indian rock band.
Took our money that we got from gigs, and that was a theme, I mean, that we followed throughout the band's life. Took our money from gigs, went to the studio, spent a week there, recorded, mostly night times, because that's when you get the cheap hours. So we'd start at 7, 8 in the evening. Somebody would bring biryani or something at around 11 o'clock at night. Would run out of water. We'll have to drink from the tap and stuff like that. And around 4 or 5 in the morning, then we'd plod off home, you know, our ears ringing from the sound, and we'd start again the next night. That would go on for 10, 15 days. Then we'd end up with a tape. And those days, there was no digital recordings.
The same year, Rock Machine started enjoying tremendous success with their great showmanship. Rock was growing in the country like never before.
I think 88 or so, the big Swedish band Europe came down to play in Bombay, and we were asked to open for them. And there must have been about 25, 30, 40,000 people at that show. So we got a lot of mileage from that show. Then secondly, there was another show called Aid Bhopal, which was in aid of the Bhopal victims for the gas disaster. That was a big show in Bombay. It was a huge event held at, I think, the Brabant Stadium. Again, upwards of 20, 25, 30,000 people there. So that got us a lot of mileage. We did very well at that show. A lot of people went home talking about the band after that show.
The same year, the band got a boost when they were chosen by the government of India to tour the then Soviet Union. Soon, Rock Machine was the face of Indian rock and roll.
Your image is important. You got to cultivate something. When you walk into that room, people should know this is the band. You know, it is important. I didn't think it was important till then. It was a huge sort of eye opener, and that's when things started happening. We started getting a little more particular. Everyone started growing their hair immediately, and trying to sort of at least get into something attractive on stage rather than going on and playing like looking like some, you know, band playing in a talent contest in your FYJC college years. So the image started taking place there, and that's very important. I think you've got to take a look at that.
By By the early 1990s, there was a major breakthrough in television in India. MTV and Channel V came in. Videos were the new trend. Gary Lawyer's At the Dawn was a hit. And, to no surprise, popularity to Indian bands brought in piracy.
MTV came in with the idea of promoting Western music. And they gave, in fact, they gave me a tremendous boost. I had this huge hit called Nights on Fire, you know, which is what we're calling the best of, you know. I say this humility, it was a huge, they promoted that song, like you could set your clock, every 2 hours it would be on. It would be on 12 times a day, and for months.
Gary found this pirated version of his album in Dubai. Rock Machine was soon renamed as Indiscreet. There was a drastic change in their sound. In 1992, Indiscreet did what no Indian band could ever attempt. One of the most glorified moments of Indian rock. MTV ranked their single Pretty Child at number 9 in the Best Videos of the World category. Like a bird on the wing, you soar through your dreams. Let your fantasies sweep the skies. But you know it's unreal, the pain is so clear. Like the tears in a baby's eyes.
Basically, it was a song that just, you know, came one day when Benny and I think Mahesh were sitting and just doodling around, and basically the song came about from there. I think Mahesh had some, just a set of chords, a progression he was working with. Uday came up with some lyrics, and then we sat and kind of arranged the song, you know, and then we figured that let's try and use something different in this. So the idea of using a sax player for the first time came about to do the solo part. Then when we were in the studio, our drummer said, look, you know, what would sound really good is tabla. And at that point, we were all like, you know, this is a sort of really cliche idea, using tabla in a tune, fusion kind of thing, which we really wanted to stay away from. And he kept saying, look, try it. If it doesn't work, we won't use it. And then we asked a great tabla player, Fazal Qureshi, to come in, and he played so fantastically. It just turned the whole song around. Mark wrote a lovely bass solo in the end, and it was such a beautifully complete song at the end of it that I'm not really surprised that it really touched people, you know, because it was a very, very genuine song.
Indiscreet continued till late 90s before the worst fear of any band came to haunt them. They disbanded.
I think, you know, when you've been together for 16 or 17 years as a band, we're very close, all of us, till this day. We meet up, we don't play together, but we meet up, we chat, we drink, we eat. We have a great time reminiscing about the old days. If you have a successful stint in a band this long, the icing on the cake, I think, is when to quit.
Millennium was a great metal band. Their music was about a message and not just simply music. Their stage showmanship and presentation combined with great music was a headbanger's ball any day. Soon they had two gigs to open for the legends Deep Purple. The band also released two videos during their opening acts for Deep Purple.